She writes, many ancient cultures had goddesses of love, sex, and pleasure. There was Frida in Scandinavia, which, by the way, is where we got the term Friday of the days of the week, Ashen in West Africa, and Rati in India. These are just to name a few. It's interesting to note that the Greek goddess Aphrodite, whose Roman name was Venus, was not just the goddess of beauty, sexuality, and seduction, but also of prosperity and victory. She was also about relating deeply and profoundly to life. So she was more than just the goddess of love and sex. And you can hear me talk more about that in episode 1 and 2, where I explain, particularly episode 2 of this show, where I explain why I named the show Awakening Aphrodite. Because one of the things I love about Aphrodite is, yes, she was absolutely beautiful. She was the most beautiful goddess. She was the goddess of love. But she was unapologetic in her needs and satisfying her needs and being who she was. She was the goddess of relationships and relating not only to herself but to others. And relationships are really what life is all about, aren't they? So there was a lot more to Aphrodite than just a beautiful face and figure. That's for sure. And that's a big reason why I picked her for our archetype on this show. And again, you can refer back to episode 2 if you want to hear more about that. So back to Christiane Northrup. The archetype of the sacred sexual goddess, which was Aphrodite, lived in our collective psyches for eons until the rise of agriculture, when the collaborative societies that worshiped the goddess were replaced by societies that worshiped the male god. Afterward, for thousands of years, cultures around the world tried to deny, suppress, control, and demonize the power of women's sexuality, severing the connection between women's bodies and the creative divine life force. These dominator societies were focused more on individual triumphs rather than on collaboration and the power of the people at the top of the hierarchy headed up by a king or emperor. While this may seem like ancient history, we can see the same ideas playing out today, even in the U.S., where some states actually have laws to enforce vaginal ultrasounds on women who chose abortion. There are legislators who believe women can't be trusted to know their own hearts and bodies well enough to make the choice without this invasive procedure. You think you're living in the modern world, and then someone proposes a law that makes you wonder what century you're in. After millennia of influence from dominator culture, it's no wonder we're so disconnected from our bodies and the creative life force associated with the earth. But deep down, we know we're meant to be sexual, sensual, life-giving, ageless goddesses. And deep down, we know that sex and spirit go hand in hand. In a survey of 4,000 women, Gina Ogden found that 47% reported that during orgasm they had experienced God, while 67% said they needed sexuality to be infused with spirituality to be satisfying. Likewise, Andrew Nürburg, MD, who studied the relationship between the brain and spiritual belief, has suggested in his book, Why God Won't Go Away, Brain Science and the Biology of Belief, that sexuality influenced by our ability to experience religious ecstasy goes hand in hand. That's not something that you're apt to learn while sitting in a church pew, that's for sure. Sexuality is power. It's our connection with the creative life force. When you connect with your Aphrodite energy, you remember that you're worthy of receiving what you desire. I'm going to repeat that again. Sexuality is power. It's our connection to the creative life force. When you connect with your Aphrodite energy, you remember that you're worthy of receiving what you desire. Remember what I said, she was unapologetic about her desires, her wants, and her wishes. You surrender to the sexual energy and other pleasures without fear or displeasing anyone, and you enjoy a bounty of sexual delight that can include multiple orgasms. Hello, wait a minute, I gotta read that again. Multiple orgasms, that just got my attention. So she writes, when you connect to that Aphrodite energy, you surrender to sexual and other pleasures without fear of displeasing anyone, and you enjoy a bounty of sexual delight that can include multiple orgasms. To embody Aphrodite is to be a diva in the original sense of the word, unapologetic about your longings and cravings, and unchecked in your pleasurable pursuits. That's hard for many of us to imagine because we've been taught not to take too much, not to laugh too loudly, not to be too aggressive in getting what we want. We've been taught to question our yearnings and make sure we're not being selfish. To become ageless, we must learn to distinguish selfishness from self-nurturing, because self-nurturing is the replenishing act of reconnecting to the energy of Aphrodite, the creative and sensual force of life itself. I'm going to read that again. To become ageless, we must learn to distinguish selfishness from self-nurturing, because self-nurturing is the replenishing act of reconnecting to the energy of Aphrodite, the creative and sensual force of life itself. To be self-nurturing is to serve the world. As Judy Harrow wrote, Aphrodite's rituals of love and pleasure are the acts which connect the inner and outer planes. We must actually dance, sing, feast, make music, and love in her honor. It is with our bodies that we worship her, and through our bodies that she blesses us. By these earthly rituals, the false divisions between body and spirit, between mind and nature, are healed. We find the sacred within us and in all things, within our beautiful living Mother Earth. So, you offer your own joy and irresistible deliciousness for others to savor, even when you're recharging your own batteries. How about that for a thought next time you feel selfish and indulging or giving yourself what feels good or that you really want? Think about that when you're recharging your own batteries, you're actually offering your own joy and pleasure and good energy to others as a gift to them. Because remember, that's the ripple effect, right? We want to be the change that we seek in the world. And we can't be it if we don't give ourselves what replenishes and refills our own cup. I know it's easier said than done. I get it. I probably see your eyes rolling as you're watching this or listening to this. I know it's hard. But next time you struggle with that, I urge you to think about that. That, you know, I'm going to be a better me. I'm going to be a more calm person, a more centered person.